right?
Yes!
The lawsuit is pending in the appellate division for the state of New York. I invite all of you to come between May 19th and the 22nd. You can call Tom and check with the students to find out exactly what day during that 4-day period and what time. It is important for us to be in the courtroom so that the court sees that people in this community and at this university are in opposition to eminent domain and are in opposition to the way Columbia University and the Empire State Development Corporation have proceeded during this 5-year battle. We filed 13 Freedom of Information requests. We had to go to court 5 times in order to win the right to get documents. We are still in the court fighting to get the documents that the court said we're entitled to. We will continue to fight. We have gotten over 8,000 documents demonstrating the process to show the bad faith between Columbia and the state of New York in order to do what they're trying to do. The documents show that, in fact, the decision was made years ago. The documents show that in the late 90s and early 2000s, the process was open and the community was involved and had input in deciding what should happen in West Harlem and Manhattanville. That's the way it's supposed to be. But then, towards the end of 2002, the process went from being open to being closed. And Columbia directed the process and the state went along with what Columbia wanted. And that, we submit, is inappropriate and illegal. We also discovered that, in fact, one of the things that's necessary for a land use expansion plan is the determination that the neighborhood, the site for the project, is blighted. But what did the state do? Listen to this one. The state hired a consultant to do a neighborhood condition study. And who was the consultant? None other than one of the consultants from Columbia. That is a classic conflict of interest. And the court has already said that, and we will be arguing that again, that the whole determination that the West Harlem area, the 18 acres from 125 to 133, from Broadway to 12th, that it is not blighted. Moreover, if it is blighted, who caused the blight? Because the very buildings that they're saying are deteriorated are by and large Columbia's buildings. It shows the pattern that Columbia purchased the buildings and let them sit there and let them deteriorate so that they could argue years later that the buildings were deteriorated. Another example, which is outrageous, they argue that the buildings are vacant, that there's no one in those buildings. But what did Columbia do? By and large, what Columbia did is they purchased the buildings, and then within 2 years, in many of the buildings that they purchased, they pushed the businesses and the residents out. So again, do you want to give someone who's doing that the benefit of then getting the very property that they purchased and did this over the years to be condemned? I say no to that. What do you say?
No!
No eminent domain. No, eminent domain is about the government condemning private property and using it for public use, a public highway, a public school, not a private university's expansion. No eminent domain. I want to hear you.
No eminent domain.
No
eminent domain.
No
eminent domain.
And finally, legal concepts, especially for the students.
Do you want one
when
of my
you
posters?
Have a determination that a neighborhood is blighted,
oh, let me get you better
that
one.
It's unsanitary, okay. That it's underutilized,
I'll roll it up.
That those words are vague, nobody knows what that actually means. And in the methodology, what happened is the process allowed the methodology to be result-oriented so that they got the result that they wanted.
Thank you so much.
Again, vacancy. When you talk about vacancy, it's when people left the inner cities in the 60s to move out to the suburbs. It's not when the owner of the property pushes people out and then argues that the property is vacant. Or utilization. The methodology here was they have a thing called floor area ratio. And in that area, it's a 2. So what happened? The consultant then comes in and says 60% will be the factor that we take into account to see whether a building is utilized or not. But if you do the math, 60% to a 2 becomes 1.2. So that means if something was less than 1.2 floors, it's underutilized. Many of the buildings in West Harlem, Manhattanville, are one-story buildings because it's garages, it's restaurants. So by definition, by saying 60% rather than 40% or 50%, by definition, any single one-story building, no matter if it's in the best condition possible, is defined as underutilized. This is bad faith. This is not what people should be doing. There should be neutral principles. There should be standards to determine what's utilized and what's not. We have the emails. We have the memos now for the Freedom of Information Law to show the court how this process was manipulated. And we will fight. We will fight in the appellate division. We will fight in the Court of Appeals. And if necessary, go to the U.S. Supreme Court. One other thing. The process in New York is unique. As far as we know, no other state in the United States, when you fight eminent domain, you go in all the other states to a trial court. You put witnesses on the stand. You cross-examine them. And you can do what you have to do. In New York, you don't go to a trial court, you go to an appellate court, and you can see how difficult it is. I will only be given 15 minutes to make all these arguments at the end of May. I can't even do that at a rally. How am I going to do it in the court? So we're challenging that to say to the courts that the way New York State deals with the issue of eminent domain is unconstitutional. We need you all to continue this fight, the community, the students, and the small businesses. If we win here, and we will win here, it will set a precedent for everyone throughout the United States of America. And it'll teach folks and inform people how you fight. So together, black, brown, red, yellow, and white together. Black, brown, red, yellow, and white together. We shall overcome. Thank you very, very much. Thank you, Norman.